Greetings, everyone. Both political parties have helped run up a $16 trillion debt, and both of the parties are certainly guilty of this problem. But the present administration has added $6 trillion of debt in 4 years to our economy. Now, what does that mean for you? That people won't really discuss how bad this can be. But I'll tell you, it's going to present a very bitter harvest to every single American. You can't escape that. Nobody can escape it. It's about what makes everything continue to work. We have to have a substantial economy to be able to do that. So we're headed for some trouble like you can't even imagine. Now, God says there is a way that you can protect yourself. He will protect you if you do your part. Now, we have to be serious about what is going on in our country. It's going to affect all of us, and it does involve you very deeply, whether you want it to or not. That's just the way it is. The president said he won't even discuss the debt ceiling with the Republicans because they want to deal with that raging spending problem that we have. Well, isn't that sort of scoffing at the Constitution, the supreme law of the land? Isn't it kind of taunting the Republicans and saying, well, okay, so what are you going to do about it? It seems to me. And it is very serious. And I think most of our people don't even have a clue of how serious it is. And we're going to cover this in our next Trumpet magazine, the hard copy. And you need to get that Trumpet magazine and read what we write about that, because I'm telling you, it is truly shocking. I mean, you need to understand what's happening in this land. Nothing like it has ever happened before. I just heard one of the most terrifying statements, that I've ever heard about our economy. Now, I want to talk to you about it today. It is the kind of thinking that's going on, and something, it seems to me, like anybody ought to figure out is tragically wrong, and deadly wrong, and dangerously wrong. When you look at the presidential election, here we had this debt like we've never had before, and even the experts and the authorities, some of them say, well, how far can this go, this debt rise, without everything just exploding into social chaos and killing and violence of every kind? They won't talk about that very much, but to themselves. Nobody has ever had a debt like America has, even proportionately to what our gross national product is. Nobody. And I'll tell you, it is a scary problem, and it's a car that has to crash. It's out of control. And yet, I want to talk to you about a comment that was made that just isn't the view of this administration. China could take their loans, demand their loans, and wreak havoc on our stock market. That's makes it a very much a national security problem. But you can explain this to most of the American people, and it's met with a big yawn. They don't understand it. They don't know anything about it, it seems like. And they're into their pleasure and their drugs and their porn and anything else that they desire. And they're not really concerned about something that it does concern them in a way they can't even possibly figure out under the present circumstances anyhow. Let me read to you what one of the top Democrats, the leader of the Senate, said on C-SPAN, March 2006, when George Bush was in the White House, President George Bush, and they were concerned about the debt that he was piling up. And here he said that they should explain why they think more debt is good for our economy. How can the Republican majority in the Congress explain to their constituents that trillions of dollars of new debt is good for our economy? Well, now it's okay, though. Now that they're in charge, well, they're adding many more trillions to that debt than President Bush ever thought of spending. He goes on to say, why is it right to increase our nation's dependence on foreign creditors? They should explain this. Yes, they should. But today he has a totally different view because, well, his party is in power in the executive office and the Senate. But let me read to you what Senator Obama at the time said, and it's in the Congressional Record, March 16, 2006. Let me read to you what he said about the debt at that time when President Bush was leading. Quote, the fact that we are here today to debate raising America's debt limit is a sign of leadership failure. It is a sign that the U.S. government can't pay its own bills. It is a sign that we now depend on ongoing financial assistance from foreign countries to finance our government's reckless fiscal policies. And he's right. He was right. But what happened to his thinking? What changed his thinking to a radical opposite point of view? He goes on to say, over the past 5 years, our federal debt has increased by $3.5 trillion. Over the past 5 years, well, he increased it $6 trillion in 4 years. Did he really, was he really serious about what he said in 2006? And he said, that's trillion with a T. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. And notice what he goes on to say, and the cost of our debt is one of the fastest growing expenses in the federal budget. This rating debt is a hidden domestic enemy. It is an enemy. It's a hidden enemy. It's not very well hidden today, except from most people who are not interested. But he was so right and explained it so powerfully. What changed? Was he sincere? Look, this affects your life in a violent and a tragic way, whether you like it or not. It is our business. It is, after all, our leaders that we voted in that are making those decisions. He goes on to say, if Washington were serious about honest tax relief in this country, we would see an effort to reduce our national debt by returning to responsible fiscal policies. Now, he has changed mightily since then, and here's an article that's from the Telegraph newspaper, December the 26th, 2012, and the title is U.S. Lambasts China for Breaches of Trade Rules. And they're just breaking them all the time. Washington has issued a blistering attack on China for persistent breaches of world trade rules and abuse of industrial secrets, accusing Beijing of failing to abide by treaty obligations. That's by Ambrose Evans Pritchard. And they're also going around stealing all kinds of our military secrets and our corporate secrets. And we don't do anything about it because, well, we owe them so much money, over $1 trillion. And what if they were to reclaim those loans? What would happen to us? What would happen to the stock market? Would it push us into another deep depression? They are not sure, but you watch, if something like that were to happen, you watch what happens to the stock market. It's going to plunge. And they, many experts know that. Let me conclude here with what Mr. Obama said in 2006. Our debt also matters internationally. My friend, the ranking member of the Senate Budget Committee, likes to remind us that it took 42 presidents 224 years to run up only $1 trillion of foreign held debt. This administration did more than that in just 5 years. Well, he's done a lot more than that in 4 years. More than double borrowing and spending. Money that we don't have. And if we can't buy it from China, we just print it. And the dollar is becoming worthless before your eyes. Worthless. That's why everybody's buying gold. They know that. But gold isn't going to save us. This is a much deeper problem than that. You can't eat gold if your economy collapses. And there's going to be fighting for food and everything else. Because your Bible says so. Bible prophecy tells you that. And this tells you how a lot of it's going to happen. Mr. Obama concluded, we must remember that the more we depend on foreign nations to lend us money, the more our economic security is tied to the whims of foreign leaders. Amen. But he doesn't seem to remember that today. And it concerns you, after all, a lot of it is your money that they're spending. But it depends on the whims of foreign leaders whose interest might not be aligned with ours. Increasing America's debt weakens us domestically and internationally. Leadership means that the buck stops here. Instead, Washington is shifting the burden of bad choices today on the backs of the children and grandchildren. Now, the future of every single America is going to be a victim of this nation-destroying debt and deficit that we have every year of over $1 trillion. And they say shortly, in a few years, it's going to be $25 trillion. And where is it going to end? You want me to tell you where it's going to end? It's going to end with the biggest crash this world has ever known. Because nobody is willing to get serious about the problem. Well, Mr. Obama's senior advisor, David Plouffe, said that he believes that vote was a mistake. He made all those powerful statements, a long dissertation there, and now he says it was a mistake. All that was a mistake? All you said there was a mistake? Notice what it says in 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 14. I'll just read the last half of that. For the children ought not to lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. Well, that's right. See, that's the way it should be in a strong economy. The parents are laying up for the children and not leaving them with a debt that they can't possibly pay. This is our problem. This is what it's all about. We're pushing God out of the picture. We don't listen to God. And what God says we must do to have a strong, stable economy and one that looks after our children and their children. You just have a certain intransigence there, and there's they're just locked into a stalemate. And the nation is bitterly divided, and with those circumstances, there's no way you can solve this problem. The only solution is to bring God into the picture and let Him solve it. But we are too self-willed to do that. We push God out of the picture. We don't want God intruding into our lives. And so God is letting us learn the hard way. God help us. Notice Proverbs 13 and verse 22. It says a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. Now, how about that? A good man or a good leader or good leaders in our politics, whether it be Republicans or Democrats, those good leaders leave an inheritance to their children, and not only to the children, but to their grandchildren. That's what God says, but who listens to God today? And we're going to regret the fact that we don't. I'll guarantee you that, because prophecy in the Bible tells me so. You look at Ezekiel 33 and verse 11, a prophecy for this end time, and it says, "Why will you die, O Israel?" And if you don't know who Israel is, write for our book on the United States and Britain and prophecy, and it will make that very clear to you, because it's a lot more than the little nation in the Middle East. But this prophecy is addressing that nation and Britain and Europe and America specifically. And we can prove that to you. I want to just close with that terrifying statement I was talking about, because this came from the Wall Street Journal, that President Obama, according to John Boehner, the Speaker of the House, said, spending is not the problem. And he went on to say, apparently, he's tired of hearing about it. Spending is not the problem. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. And that just the fact that that statement is made ought to strike terror in our hearts at a time when we ought to really get a grip on spending. It's just full speed ahead. Don't worry about it. That's not the problem. Let's just spend our way into financial, fiscal health. And that's never going to solve anything. And anybody that has a sound mind economically ought to know that. We're in the midst of a raging fiscal fire. And we're on a train that's out of control. And we say, well, that's not the problem. Let's just go a little faster into disaster. Can you imagine the U.S. descending into chaos, even to the point of our cities being burned with fire? Another end time prophecy in Isaiah 1 and verse 7. You ought to read that, and you ought to write for our Ezekiel booklet if you don't have it, because again, these are Bible prophecies, and God says they're there and they're going to be fulfilled. And he says, you need protection, and he will protect those who are loyal to him and obedient to him and do his work and proclaim his warning to this world and try to get some of them to listen. But most of them are not. That's a prophecy as well. And you see, just consistently hear more and more about some commentators on radio and even television talking about being depressed because of all of this bad news, and it just seems to get worse and worse and worse, and they can't do anything to stop it. And did you know that depression and that discouragement is going to intensify until they suffer and suffer and suffer because of their sins, and then until they get to know God? That's what Ezekiel 6 says. Until they get to know God. That's the purpose of all this. That's why God lets it go. It's going to produce an amazing end, a wonderful good news for all of us. But why do we have to suffer so long before we'll finally learn that lesson? God says it is nevertheless going to get us to know God, and that's all that really matters in the end. Until next week, this is Gerald Fleury. Goodbye, friends.